This is a picture test in practical neuroanatomy. You may use the video as a revision for the topic or as a self-assessment tool. For the purpose of self-assessment, you may pause the video and spend your own time to read the question and come up with the answer, then replay the video to confirm your answer by listening to the comments and explanations. Now I will deal with the sectional anatomy of the brain. Identify the cortical regions 1 to 3. This is a coronal section of the cerebrum showing the temporal lobe inferior to the lateral sulcus. On the medial aspect of the inferior surface of the temporal lobe, the section passes through the parahippocampal gyrus. The hippocampus develops as an expansion from the medial edge of the temporal lobe and folds upon itself to occupy the floor of the inferior horn of the lateral ventricle, which is also shown here. Thus, 1 is the hippocampus, the infolded part. 2 is a region of the cortex that is located at the top margin of the parahippocampal gyrus. It is called the subiculum. It is the transitional zone between the 6-layered cortex of the parahippocampal gyrus and the 3-layered cortex of the hippocampus. Note here that there is a small trace on the medial side of the hippocampus of the dentate gyrus. Again, the dentate gyrus is part of the limbic system, together with the hippocampus, subiculum, and parahippocampal gyrus. Also, note here that in the roof of the inferior horn of the lateral ventricle, you can also detect a small amount of gray matter, sectioned gray matter, which represents the tail of the caudate nucleus. Choroid plexus can also be seen within the cavity of the inferior horn of the lateral ventricle. Identify the line. What does it represent? In which cerebral cortex is this line prominent? In this stained section, the blue stain is staining the white matter, that's to say the nerve fibers. So the line is a line formed by a bunch of nerve fibers that are passing tangentially, that's to say parallel, to the surface of the cerebral cortex. In sensory cortices, which are termed as heterotypical granular cortices, in general, the internal granular layer, layer 4 of the cortex, is thickened, and this is with a concomitant reduction of the adjacent pyramidal layers. Now, this thickening of layer 4 occurs because layer 4 in sensory cortices receives particularly profuse projections from sensory thalamic nuclei. These incoming fibers, thalamic fibers, they terminate preferentially in layer 4, thus they form a line of white matter within the gray cortex. In the primary visual cortex, Brodmann's area 17, in the walls of the calcarine sulcus of the occipital lobe, this line can be visible even to the unaided eye, and it is known as the line of Gennari. Because of the presence of the line of Gennari, the primary visual cortex is known alternatively as the striate area or the striate cortex, because it is striated with this line. This structure, line of Gennari, is named for its discoverer, Francesco Gennari, who first observed it in 1776 when he was a medical student at the University of Parma. Identify the structures. This is a coronal section of the brain at the level of the anterior commissure, 6. Fibers are stained in blue, while the gray matter is light pink. The cavities shown here are the lateral ventricles on either side and the third ventricle in the midline. Now, this is the central part or body of the lateral ventricle. You can see the boundaries here. The boundaries is the corpus callosum, number 2, a bundle of commissural fibers, so it stains dark blue. It forms the roof of the body of the lateral ventricle. The septum pellucidum bridges the interval between the fornix, 5, and the corpus callosum in the midline. The fornix is a fiber bundle in the limbic system, hence, again, it also stains darkly blue. The floor of the body of the lateral ventricle includes part of the dorsal surface of the thalamus, where you can see two groups of its nuclei, the anterior group 4 and the lateral group 3. The body of the caudate nucleus, number 1, forms a ridge along the lateral border of the floor of the central part or the body of the lateral ventricle. Lateral to the thalamus is the internal capsule. The internal capsule is a massive fiber bundle made up of projection fibers. Hence, they are also stained dark blue. The internal capsule separates the thalamus, 3, from the gray matter of the lentiform nucleus. The lentiform nucleus is located lateral to the internal capsule. And as you can see it here, it is wedge-shaped or lens-shaped, hence the name lentiform. It has a medial part called the globus pallidus, number 9, and a lateral part, the putamen, 10. The globus pallidus is traversed by numerous myelinated axons. The presence of large number of axons in the globus pallidus will give it a pale appearance in fresh sections, hence the name globus pallidus, the pale body. But in this stain, its numerous fibers will give it a darker hue than the laterally located putamen, 10. The caudate and lentiform nuclei are together called the corpus striatum, and this is involved in the control of motor activity. The caudate nucleus and putamen are connected anatomically and closely related functionally. Thus, they are classified as neostriatum or striatum, while the globus pallidus is designated as the paleostriatum or pallidum. Numerous strands of gray matter, they join the caudate nucleus with the putamen by cutting across the internal capsule. You can see at least one of them here. Because of these connections through the internal capsule, then the name corpus striatum. 7 is the column of the fornix. It is here in its way to the mammillary bodies. A 64-year-old male suffered vascular lesion of the brainstem. Few days later, he presented with dysphagia. On examination, the uvula was deviated toward the left side, involvement of which of the labeled brainstem nuclei results in the clinical presentation. Dysphagia, difficulty in swallowing, would result from paralysis of the muscles of the pharynx and upper part of the esophagus. Deviation of the uvula indicates that one side of the soft palate has been paralyzed. In this case, the uvula will deviate away from the affected side, being pulled by the acting muscle. The muscles that provide motor innervation to the muscles of the palate, pharynx, and larynx, as well as the striated muscles of the upper end of the esophagus, is the nucleus ambiguus. This nucleus consists of a small group of motor neurons, difficult to find in this section, but they are located within the reticular formation, medial to the spinal nucleus of the trigeminal, and posterior to the dorsal accessory olivary nucleus. So it's either C or D. Since the uvula deviated toward the left, then the right side was affected by the vascular lesion. So the answer is D. Nucleus ambiguus on the right side is involved in this vascular lesion, resulting in the clinical presentation. The vascular lesion is mostly a lateral medullary syndrome, resulting from a lesion affecting a branch of the posterior inferior cerebellar artery. Such patients would also present with ataxia resulting from involvement of the inferior cerebellar peduncle, vertigo resulting from involvement of the vestibular nuclei, although the history of the patient doesn't show this involvement. The other nuclei shown here are A and B, which represent the hypoglossal nuclei, and the dorsal nucleus of the vagus E. Although the vagus is the nerve that carries motor innervation to the muscles affected in this patient, but the origin of these motor fibers are not included in the dorsal vagal nucleus. The dorsal motor nucleus of the vagus consists of parasympathetic preganglionic neurons, which innervate the viscera of the thorax and abdomen and is not involved in the innervation of the muscles of the palate, pharynx, and larynx. But the fibers of the nucleus ambiguus will accompany the vagus nerve and supply these muscles. A lower motor neuron lesion in nucleus 1 results in deviation of the eye to which of the following directions? The nucleus here is the motor nucleus of the oculomotor nerve. It is located in the anterior part of periaqueductal gray matter at the level of the superior colliculus, where here you can also see the red nucleus in the tegmentum. The red nucleus is level of the superior colliculus. The motor nucleus of the oculomotor supplies all the extraocular muscles of the eyeball, except two of them. The two muscles that will still be in function are therefore the superior oblique supplied by the trochlear nerve and lateral rectus supplied by the abducens nerve. Superior oblique moves the eyeball downward and laterally, while the lateral rectus moves the eyeball laterally. Combined together, they will move the eye downward and laterally in the absence of opposing action of the muscles supplied by the oculomotor nerve. So the correct answer here is down and out A. Part B of the question, the preganglionic fibers in B synapse in which cranial parasympathetic ganglion? The interrupted dark lines in B represent the oculomotor nerve that emerges from the midbrain in the interpeduncular fossa. Note here that in this stain, nerve tracts are darkly stained. The oculomotor nerve is connected centrally to its motor nucleus, number one, which has been just described, but dorsal to the main oculomotor nucleus is the Edinger-Westphal nucleus. This contains preganglionic parasympathetic neurons. Axons from Edinger-Westphal nucleus traverse the oculomotor nerve to reach the orbit where they relay in the ciliary ganglion. And postganglionic fibers from the ciliary ganglion pass through short ciliary nerves to supply the sphincter pupillae and ciliary muscles. So the answer here in B, the ganglion is the ciliary ganglion, one of the four parasympathetic ganglia which are present in the head: ciliary, pterygopalatine, submandibular, and otic ganglia. Identify the fibers indicated by the arrows. List four cranial nerves whose fibers terminate on the nucleus indicated by the star. The arrows in one indicate the internal arcuate fibers, representing axons of second-order neurons in the nucleus gracilis and cuneatus. These internal arcuate fibers, they arch ventrally and medially to cross the midline in the sensory decussation. The crossed fibers then ascend to form the medial lemniscus. They are part of the dorsal system that carries modalities of discriminative touch, proprioception, and vibration. The star here in 2 is marking the spinal nucleus of the trigeminal nerve. This nucleus consists of sensory neurons that mediate pain and temperature sensations from the head. These neurons are derived mainly from the trigeminal nerve, but it also includes fibers from other nerves which participate in the sensory innervation of the head, and these include the facial nerve, glossopharyngeal, and vagus nerves. However, it's the trigeminal nerve that is the main sensory contributor for general sensation in the head, hence the name of the nucleus, the spinal nucleus of the trigeminal nerve. Identify the cortical regions 1 and 2. 1 is the insula, or the island of Rill. It is an area of cortex buried in the depth of the lateral sulcus of the cerebral hemisphere. The insula has diverse functions, including the control of visceral activities and homeostasis by the autonomic nervous system. 2 is the location of the primary visual cortex on the sides of the calcarine sulcus. This is located on the medial surface of the occipital lobe.